not just Zoo. Look at Lou Will. Look at Kawhi, ready to help. And obviously, we know Kawhi's a one-man fast breaker. How about that? Two? Can they call two fouls on one play?
I was going to say.
Those good looks. Markel got two defenders on him. Nice job there.
Great recovery by Aaron Gordon.
Got a run. Kyle Lowry's still arguing with the officials.
Smart deflects it and comes up with a steal. Two-on-one break for the Celtics. Smart. The scoop layup is good. You throw out all the cliches when you're talking about Marcus Smart, the heart and soul, the glue. He's also been exceptional this year.
Races it down the court, defended by Gary Trent Jr. Mello fades at it. Gary Trent Jr. sends that to the floor.
Nice pass. Jokic into Millsap. Missed the first. LeBron swipes it away. And a foul inside and hitting the deck hard is Millsap.
Why not? LeBron James out here doing a little bit of everything, including giving guys whiplash here.
That's the right play as Kemba Walker makes the right play there, coming up with a steal.
Oh, wow. Morant with a rejection.
He didn't quit on a play. He had the turnover on one and didn't hang his head at all. And then goes down and makes a spectacular rundown block.
Doncic stops on the baseline. Great feed and a better block by Covington. He put Porzingis in the friend zone on that block.
The women of professional basketball are in the wobble, as it is being called by players and team personnel.
Seconds remaining. Denver a foul to give. Jokic trying to disrupt Rondo. He puts it in. Here's Davis. 4-3 in the win. Oh, it's good! Anthony Davis has won it for the Lakers!
The Lakers, with their sixth straight playoff win, take a 2-0 lead in the Western Conference Finals. I'm your host for Playoff Central Live, Chris Miles. Sam Mitchell's here with me now. Nikola Jokic scored 11 straight points for the Nuggets in the fourth quarter, but Anthony Davis with the final 10 for the Lakers in the three that sealed the victory, 105-103. Sam, what an ending.
Chris, that was a great game, great ending. Look, the Lakers looked like they were going to put the Denver Nuggets away several times during this game. Every time they would take their foot off the gas, the Denver Nuggets would come rolling back. The Joker finally figured out the Lakers' defense. He went to work in the fourth quarter. He and Anthony Davis had an unbelievable battle. But at the end, the team that with the ball last won the game. And Chris, if you go back and watch that play was for LeBron James. Anthony Davis said it. That play was not for him. It was for LeBron James. Rondo and AD had some eye contact, because you go back and look at the play, that was supposed to be a switch. Right here, LeBron wanted the ball just to post up right there on the elbow. He was calling for it. And you watch this play right here. Plumlee is screaming for Grant to switch. And Grant does a switch. And that allows AD to come off wide open. If Grant switches that, then he switches right into a steal. But because they thought the play was for LeBron James, and it was, because if you look at the play, LeBron didn't set a screen for Anthony Davis. He just ran Plumlee off LeBron James.
Yeah, LeBron calling for the ball got a lot of attention, but that wasn't the only big play down the stretch. It looked like the Lakers were going to cruise to another 10-point victory. They came into this one with four straight playoff wins by 10 or more, but kudos to the Nuggets. They fought back. They were down for most of the game, and then late, down by four, Nikola Jokic made his first three of the series. Then Jamal Murray pulls up, great defense, maybe some contact. Doesn't matter. Nikola Jokic tips it in, and the Nuggets take the one-point lead. Jokic, 11 straight points again for the Nuggets. But then there's this play. The Lakers coming right back. Anthony Davis, we said it before, 10 straight points for the Lakers. On the other end, it's Jokic again right over Anthony Davis. But again, Sam, that play you're pointing to, there was still 2 seconds left on the clock. After this move by LeBron, he drives and dishes Alex Caruso with the open look. No good. But this is the deciding play of the game. Kudos to Jamal Murray with that block there. But again, let's watch this play, Sam. What do you see from LeBron James calling for the ball?
Well, LeBron is posting up, and Plumlee, it wasn't a screen. Plumlee just could have followed Anthony Davis and denied the ball. But he was playing it as if it was a play. He was screaming for the switch and Jeremy Grant. And that's just poor communication on Denver Nuggets' part. But give Anthony Davis credit, because even though he understood that play was for LeBron, he and Rondo recognized that they had a huge advantage with Plumlee guarding AD. They felt like AD could get some separation and get a good look. And AD came off in stride and informed and knocked it down.
22 points in the second half for Anthony Davis. The Denver Nuggets, good sports about this one. That didn't just happen. You got to think about their comeback and how hard they fought to be in the final minutes of this game to take the lead, only for AD to hit the big three. But, Sam, he had 9 points at the half, and we all heard Charles Barkley say it, that Anthony Davis is a bit of a passive player and a guy with a ton of talent, but not playing at an MVP-like level. Not that AD heard those comments, but it sure felt like he did.
Well, I'm sure it was people in that locker room, the coaches, his teammates telling him he needs to step it up. This is what they brought him to L.A. for, to compete for championship. He's the guy. And I said this before the playoffs started, Chris. For the Lakers to win the championship, Anthony Davis needs to play like MVP of the playoffs. Because we know what LeBron James is going to do, but we had no idea what Anthony Davis was going to do, because this is rare air for him. But Chris, he has stepped up and shown out. He is playing lights out. He's like a 7-foot small forward with unbelievable ball skills. And then when you need him to make some gritty, grimy, tough plays, he can do that. But Chris, look at these moves and shots that he's making. These are moves that 6'7", 6'8", small forwards make. And Anthony Davis doing this in the 7-foot frame. And look at the form of that jump shot. Coming off a screen, catch and shoot. That reminds me of Ray Allen. And last but not least, Chris, I'm going to say this. That tip by the Joker, show you how old I am. Remember Ralph Sampson tipping that ball in on the inbound pass against the Lakers to go to the NBA Finals? The presence of mind for the Joker to do that, he realized that shot was blocked. It was going to be short. And that was a controlled tip on his part. That wasn't luck.
Well, Nikola Jokic sure playing like an all-time great in the playoffs, in the series, and really for his career so far. Anthony Davis, 68 points in his first two Western Conference Finals games. So he's certainly
MVP
playing.
MVP of the Conference Finals?
So far, it has to be, right? It has to be Anthony Davis right now. There you go, Sam. Michael Malone talking to the media right now.
The decision to play PJ Dozier late in the third quarter and the effect and the impact that he had on you guys throughout the rest of the game.
Yeah, I thought PJ was great. You know, he gave us a bigger defender, made some big plays for us offensively. He feels awful about the missed free throws, but... You know, Monte was out there playing well, kind of rolled his ankle a little bit. Wanted to give PJ an opportunity, and I thought PJ did a great job.
Go to Malika Andrews next. Malika, go ahead.
No. Feels like we're down in the series, and we've got to win game three. That's been our mindset in the first round, the second round, and we're in the same situation here. Whether you're down 3-1 or 2-0, obviously next game is the biggest game for us.
All right, we'll go to Vic Lombardi next. Vic, go ahead.
Coach, final shot notwithstanding, is that the pace of the game that you want to play? Is that the pace that makes it more your way?
Well, we did a much better job of taking away their transition. You know, and that was a huge point of emphasis going in. So to clean that up allowed us to be in the game. And I thought our defense in that second half was tremendous. 22 points, 23 points. So that's where it starts with us. Our defense will keep us in games. We're 8-8 in the postseason, and our 8 wins, our defense has been great. And we gave ourselves a chance tonight. And unfortunately, Anthony Davis hits an incredible shot to kind of take that win away from us. But defensive transition was tremendous. If we can continue that, we'll continue to give ourselves a chance.
All
We will end with Tim Reynolds. Tim, go ahead.
Yeah, I mean, it's, you know, losing sucks. I mean, that's the bottom line. Losing sucks. Some guys like to win. Some guys hate to lose. And I think we're a group of guys that hate to lose, whether it be by 20-something points in game one or at the buzzer tonight. It counts as the same. The only thing you can talk about tonight is that we were in the game tonight, and they had to rely on a great shot, a great player to beat us at the buzzer. But as long as we're putting ourselves in position to win games, that's all you can ask for. But one thing I know about our group, Tim, even though we're disappointed, we're frustrated, we're angry, we'll use that motivation to come out and try to take game three, take it one game at a time.
Tonight's Shot Chart presented by Kaiser Permanente. And who else but the guy that hit the game winner, both of his threes, from this nearly the same area. Sam, what do you see in this shot chart from Anthony Davis?
I see consistency. Look, Anthony Davis understood where his bread was buttered at. Look, man, he stopped worrying about those threes. He started getting inside the paint from 17 feet in, and he was lethal, man, because when he unfolds at the basket, you can't guard him. This is the play right here. Look, LeBron James is calling for a post-up. All the Lakers was on the side. Stop it. The only time you switch in this situation, if there's a screen, Plumlee should have stayed with Anthony Davis and just ridden through there, and he could have walked into a steal. But because he was anticipating the screen, he played the play. And as you know, Chris, anytime you play the play, there's always counters. And that was just a huge mistake for Denver because Plumlee, because there wasn't a screen, he should have just stayed with Anthony Davis. He screened himself. Because Grant was just locked into guarding LeBron James. All Plumlee had to do with an elbow in Anthony Davis' chest and the opposite arm extended, just ride him over, and they couldn't even got the ball in play. Because the play would have been dead because at that point, LeBron James could not have posted up and got the ball in bounds.
Sam, one thing we paid close attention to in game one was the foul battle and the free throws. The Lakers, 18 for 19 from the free throw line in game two. The Nuggets missed 8 free throws, and they took 33 of them. That's something that, as a coach, you point to afterwards, right, and said, man, if we just hit a couple more of our free throws, maybe we come out with this win.
Well, Coach Malone set the tone for that. You knew that it was going to be flip-flop because he made a point after game one to talk about the free throw, how many the Lakers shot in that first quarter. So he was sending a message to the officials that, you know, he wanted to see the Nuggets get to the line. They did a great job of getting to the line. The Lakers committed a lot of fouls. But at the end of the day, Chris, you got to step up there and knock them down. Give the Lakers credit, man. And to go up there and shoot the way they shot and for Denver to miss some key free throws at the end. And it comes down to possessions like that, Chris. Turnovers, missed free throws, or missed opportunities to win games as well.
Well, we don't have to give the Lakers any
couple shots to go early, and I was just trying to be aggressive while I was in there.
All right, I don't have any hand. Okay, we'll go to Nalo.
Michael, that last shot was very impressive for AD. What do you think went wrong with you guys on that specific rotation, maybe on Plumlee? What do you think, your thoughts on it?
That's just not on one player. We're a team, so when we're out there, we got to communicate, especially with 2 seconds left on the clock. So we had a defensive breakdown. He got free. But that's on the whole team, not just on one person. And it was an amazing shot as well.
We'll go to Helene Elliott.
Hi. Your coach was saying that a loss is a loss. It doesn't matter if it's by 1 or 2 or 22. Do you feel that way or just it hurt more that you came so close?
It definitely hurts more because we were up 1 with a couple seconds left. We were this close from getting the win. But, he's right. We're 0-2 in the series right now. So, got to find a way to muster up some strength and come back game 3, play even better than we play tonight.
Go back to looks like he lowers his hand. Do I have any more questions? Go back to Manala.
Yes, my bad. What do you think you guys need to do now for this third game? Everybody knows that the Denver Nuggets have something under the sleeve. What do you think needs to be done to take care of business and take this series 2-1?
Just make the necessary adjustments. We play better tonight than we played in game one. Just take another step forward. And we're a resilient team. We're not going to let this get us. Of course, guys are sad right now, but we're not going to let us get too down, and we'll be ready to go game three.
We'll go back to Helene.
Thanks. I was just going to ask, what positives, what are the biggest positives you can take that you think you can build on from this game for game three?
Definitely a lot of positives. I think different guys made a lot of big plays. You know, P.J. Dozier went in there, had some big minutes at the end. So we definitely could take some positives away and put all that together and stick together and then come out and get a win in game three.
Don't have any more hands at the moment.
Do
we have any more questions for Michael?
Thank you.
Alex Caruso taking the Nuggets to flight school. 9 points, but those the best looking ones. Also had a chance to ice this one late in regulation as well. That led to Anthony Davis making a big shot. Here's Alex Caruso.
AD's taking the shot. What are you feeling as the ball's going in?
It's going in. I mean, I have a good – every time AD shoots the ball, I think it's going in. So even more so in the later part of the game. But just, you know, we've tried to find a way to win games late all season. You know, we've done it different ways. Different people have stepped up. We didn't execute offensively as well, and then they made a couple tough shots. You know, Joker hits a tough one over me, and then Murray airballs it, and Joker just kind of flips his hand there and tips it in. You know, credit to them for battling. But we got to finish the game better. You know, up 8 points with a couple minutes left, we got to close out the game better.
Dan? Alex, early in the game, I think the first time out, we're sitting around it, and you're the loudest voice talking to guys before coaches come in, talking to players and things like that. How comfortable are you in those situations, and has that evolved as your role has kind of been cemented and grown bigger?
I've always kind of been like that. You know, I've always being vocal has always been easy for me. It's kind of come natural, and outside of this team, I've usually been one of the leaders on the team. You know, one of the best players on my team growing up, different levels of basketball. So being vocal is, like I said, pretty natural for me, and I got the trust of my teammates that they understand what I'm talking about, and I can say what I need to say, and it doesn't fall on deaf ears.
Son of a coach too? Like.
Yeah, a little bit. Just you know, I don't know why I'm like the way I am. I'm really competitive, man, and if there's something I think needs to be said to win, I'm gonna do it. I'm gonna leave no stone unturned to get the job done.
Okay, well.
All right, Alex, I've got three more here. We're gonna take Brad's turn. How you doing, Alex? I mean, knowing how tough Denver is, they won a series twice, they came back. When you guys had the 16-point lead, are you not surprised that they actually came back? And what did you guys do to kind of just maintain your composure before the game out?
Yeah, you know, I mean, obviously we know they're a comeback team, they're a second-half team. If you've watched any of their games in the playoffs, they've been down double digits numerous times and come back and won. So it was no surprise to us that they were fighting and that they were – you know, scrapping at the end to make it a game. We just got to do a better job of holding ourselves to a higher standard. You know, when we get up in games and we're in double-digit leads, it's about putting our foot on the gas and extending it and not just coasting to the end of the game. We got championship aspirations. If championship teams, they play 48-minute games, and we're working towards doing that.
Hey, Alex, you mentioned earlier that the offense wasn't executing the way you guys are capable of doing it. Beyond just turnovers, what were you seeing in terms of what could explain that?
Yeah, you know, that has a lot to do with it. Just the lack of chemistry, but the lack of rhythm it creates on offense. You know, you have a good stretch on defense, and you might have three possessions where you get fouled one and then turn it over twice. You just don't have that rhythm, that movement, the flow of the game that that you need to be a good offensive team. And for us, it's about playing with pace. And every time that we have to stop the game for free throws or we have to take the ball out of bounds because they scored, it hurts our offense. So it's about, firstly, you know, playing defense and getting out, but even on makes, just playing with pace and then making sure late in games we're spaced the right way so we can get good shots.
Well, you heard Caruso said, spread the floor so we can get some good shots. Lakers' Rondo returned to the lineup. He had 9 of the Lakers' 23 assists.
Hello. All right, you guys can get started there. We'll try to get Allie.
Okay. Rajan, what did you see in the game-winning play and the inbounds? And what was your confidence that AD could make that check?
As soon as Joker, I guess, got the bucket on AD and the other end, I told him, I'm right back. I wasn't in the game, but I planned on him getting the ball the next possession and scoring right back on him. And fortunately, it just happened to go that way.
All righty, Dan?
You guys saw what Denver did last series. You guys saw what Denver did the series before. What did you see from them in the second half tonight to fight back? And how were you guys able to withstand that fight?
They got stops. You know, give them credit. They got stops in the fourth quarter. We struggled offensively. They made shots as well. They got offensive rebounds. They did it all in the fourth, and we're able to claw back in the game.
Oh shit!
Will, any on your end?
Yeah, we'll take a couple more. Let's get Allie Clifton again. See if she's here. Allie. All right.
No, we're good. We have a couple, please. He wanted to, yes.
Hey, Rajan. Hey, can you, and I apologize, I missed the start of this, so if you already addressed it a few minutes ago, but can you describe the unspoken communication you have with AD? He mentioned that, you know, you guys kind of just made eye contact on that last play, and obviously then that helps facilitate a little more.
I think I made eye contact with every player on my team that play. My first look was Kenny backdoor, that wasn't there. Danny backdoor wasn't there. Brian and I looked out at, but he didn't move. And then I saw AD coming on the outside and just try to get it to him on time on target. I had Joker on me, so obviously I couldn't throw a lob pass, and you know he did the rest.
Rachel, John, you played with Anthony in New Orleans. How much, even back then, was he wanting to get into games at this level? And how have you watched him sort of grow into being at this level of competition and making what was probably the biggest shot of his life tonight?
I definitely agree. It was the biggest shot of his life so far. You know, watching him grow, obviously I played with him a couple of years back, and to where he's come now, he's always been a dominant force for any opponent he's ever played against. But see him grow and hit a shot in this type of environment, Western Conference Final, doesn't really get any bigger than this. And you know, I'm extremely happy for him as a teammate, as a friend, and I love watching him grow.
When you know someone is such a high skill level player but just hasn't been at that level of competition yet, is it just as a guy who has been there, do you want it for them even more?
Absolutely. And then, you know, to have him on my side, you know, I definitely feel comfortable. Even, like I said, when they went up one, there was never a doubt. AD had it going the second half, and he was scoring from inside out. And fortunately, like I said, he hit the three at the end, but he's, you know, arguably the best scorer in our game. You know, 7 feet tall. He can take bigs off the dribble. He can post smalls. He's a foul magnet, shooting 99% from the line. So he's definitely a great option to have. And also LeBron, 1A, 1B, it doesn't matter. But yeah, two guys on the floor, they're going to draw a foul or get a lot of them looking.
All right, Dan?
Nikola Jokic, 30 points, including the last 11 for the Denver Nuggets in the loss.
I mean, we were there before. I think the second or third game against Clippers, I think we had it and we kind of lost it in the end. So we put the effort there, we put the fight. Yeah, we lost the game, but I think the we played well most of the game. We were down, we came back again. So we're going to keep our heads up and on to the next one.
Next, we'll go to Vic Lombardi. Vic, go ahead.
Nikola, losing the way you did certainly sucks, but you
think he's figured something out. The obvious momentum and that.
I mean, you know, they're two. They have two really good players. They have LeBron, who is the probably best player in the league, and they have AD, who is the probably best scorer in the league. So I think it's not easy to figure it out. They are really talented. We can just make them tougher, make them feel uncomfortable. So answer that question, maybe. But they're really talented. They're gonna find solutions. So we just need to kind of stay on top and just make them uncomfortable.
Next, we'll go to Sean Keeler. Sean, go ahead.
Nikola, again, it's so emotional, a roller coaster game. Can you take something from kind of your one-on-one with Dwight Howard and getting kind of the last lap there until the end and some of that tete-a-tete?
I mean, it's a basketball game, you know, so he's a big guy. He knows his role, and he's doing really well, you know, so. But it's not just me against him. It's Nuggets against Lakers. Yeah.
Next, we'll go to Kendra Andrews. Kendra, go ahead.
Kind of following up on that. I mean, you're not just going up against Dwight Howard, but you're sorry. Here, I'll turn up my volume.
No. I don't. I hear you.
Okay. You're not just going up against Dwight Howard, but also JaVale McGee and just all of the big that they have. How hard is that for you to continuously having to go up against, you know, four different bigs in the same game instead of maybe getting some relief by mismatches down the stretch?
You know, to be honest, I don't think about it. You know, I just whoever is on over there, I'm gonna try to beat him and try to win the game. So it is what it is. I can say it's not just me against them, it's Nuggets against Lakers.
Next we'll go to Sam Amick. Sam, go ahead.
Can you give your view of the last play? Were you surprised?
I mean, it's gonna be him or LeBron, so we kind of knew it. It was happened a little bit miscommunication. I think I had a really good contest, to be honest. I think I was right there, but as soon as he shot the ball, he shot it really well. I kind of felt it that it's going in, and I think it was a swish. So it was great players make great shots. So and he did it. So he's a really good player. To be honest, I don't know, and I didn't even ask it. It happened, I mean, so it's passed, so it happened.
Next we'll go to Mark Medina. Mark, go ahead.
Hey, Nikola. Given your guys' resiliency during this whole playoffs, where do you guys draw from that, from those previous years, and also in tonight's game to be able to overcome this greatest challenge?
I mean, we are underdogs. Is that how you say underdogs?
Underdogs.
Yeah. I mean, we need to fight. That's our only chance. You know, we could. They were up 15, isn't it, or 16? I don't know how much they were up. We could just like call it a game and quit. But you know, I think we just want to get give the fight. You know, we just maybe it's gonna be a 30 point, but. Fight needs to be there, an effort.
We heard from the Joker. We're still waiting to hear from
on NBA TV.
The first season of GM School was good. I'm sure the second season will be as well. LeBron James, 26 points, 11 rebounds, 4 assists, and 6 turnovers.
Nah, did you see my reaction after you made it?
I didn't get to see
it. You didn't get to see it? Oh, well. I tried to chase him down just like every last one of the teammates and staff that we had out there. A special moment for a special player. Happy to be a part of it.
What is it
to take on the pressure to make a, to first of all want a shot like that, to take it, to make it? And what do you think the fact that he was able to have that kind of moment would do for his confidence going forward in situations like this?
Well, it's not about making a shot. It's about having a belief of just taking it for one and living with the result. You know, I think right back, you know, to our game right before COVID hit, we played Brooklyn at home, and he had a similar shot right there on that left wing, right in front of their bench for us to win the game, and he missed it. And he was down on himself, but at the end of the day, I told him, I said, listen, man, if you open, and I was able to drive the, you know, that particular game and find him wide open, and he just missed it. But it's just the confidence to take the shot. You're not going to make them all, but the belief that just take it and live with the results is what it's all about. And you know, tonight was, you know, his moment. Tonight was his moment to just, you know, find a space, you know, hunt the ball down. You know, in our top 10 in assists, one of our top 10 in assists leaders in Rondo was able to find him, and he knocked it down. It was a big time play.
Alan?
Calgoon?
Even before that, he and Jokic were trading buckets. I mean, were you just getting a sense that he was sort of rising to that particular duel even before that game-winning shot?
No, it's not about an individual matchup. It's about us trying to execute and him just coming through for us. And, you know, that's what he did. It wasn't, okay, you know, Joker, your turn, my turn. Well, no, it was just about playing the game and finding ways to try to make an impact. And, you know, obviously those two big shots he had at the end, one was the floater to take the lead, and Joker was able to get the tip in, and then he comes back with the three. You know, just a, you know, just big-time plays, like I said, for a big-time player.
Okay. Rachel?
Well, Brian, AD is the kind of player who had a skill set to do this for a long time, but that he is now with a team that is at a championship level, competing for a championship, competing for conference finals. What do you think that's like for him to finally get to be in the big moments that match the skills that he has?
I don't know. It's definitely an AD question, but I'm just happy to have him. I know what he brought to the table. I know what he's about. I know his skill set, and, you know, that's why I wanted him here so badly.
Chris?
Well, you guys didn't have a timeout on the last play right there. How were you able to talk about a scenario in which something like that could happen before?
No, I mean, that's what this floor right here that we're on right now is all about. It's the practices, it's the shoot-arounds, and we talk about every single scenario possible. Up three, down three, up two, down two. Do we have a foul to give? Do we not? Do we have a timeout? Do we not? Are we going full court, half court, BOB, which is baseline out of bounds, SOB, sideline out of bounds? You know, you talk about all those things. And for, if you want to be a championship ball club, you have to be able to do that on the fly. So knowing that we didn't have a timeout, we were able to get into a situation, into a set that we've worked on in practice and get right to it. And the first option was for me, if Doe saw me over the top. If not, the AD flashes and the rest is history.
Dan?
LeBron, you said it's not making the shot, it's taking it. Caruso stepped into the shot similarly, took it right away. He's been really vocal in huddles and stuff like that. Where does he kind of fit on your leadership hierarchy on this team? How valuable is that part of his confidence to speak up and step in and take a shot?
When you're trying to play high-level basketball, you got to have high-level IQ players, and he's one of them. And not only does he have high-level IQ, he also plays with a high energy. And we know we're going to get out of him every night. It's not about him making shots, but we know he's going to defend, and he's going to play at a level that he's capable of playing at, and we all know that once he checks into the game every single night. So we know what to expect out of him. And you know, to be honest, when he makes shots, it's extra credit for us. But he puts that work in, you know, on his offensive skill set to get better and better. And, you know, we love everything about him.
Willing leader, too, it seems like.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
All right, we'll throw it back to Tanisha.
Mike Trudell.
Hey, LeBron, Mike Trudell in L.A. If I could jump off the court for a second, if I read the sweatshirt correctly, it said change isn't made from watching on the sidelines or more than a vote sweatshirt that you wore on the way in. I just wanted to ask you about that. where your mindset is as this run continues, and where your mind is outside of the court?
For sure. I mean, I know we're here, you know, playing the game, but I'm not losing the fact of, you know, what's important as well. And more than a vote is about, you know, protecting Black voters and voter suppression that goes on in our communities. You know, and like you said, it's not, changes are made by sitting on the sidelines, and that's one of our slogans, and we're very proud of that. And, you know, getting, you know, the people that want to join us, getting them gear and wearing the T-shirts and wearing the hats and wearing the hoodies, because when they go in their community, it's something they can continue to enlighten, continue to educate, continue to, you know, make people empower about this movement. And, you know, because, you know, we always talk about change, you know, in our communities. And now we have an opportunity. We have an opportunity to really create change for the better. And we look forward to this opportunity.
And if I could flip back to the court, going back to 2009, remember the bank shot, of course, but the shot against Orlando. What was it like that night going to sleep? And I know this is a question for AD too, but what is that? They hit a shot that you kind of dream of growing up, right? Isn't that kind of what that situation?
I mean, to be completely honest, man, it was probably one of the greatest moments of my career up until that point. You know, just knowing the situation, we were about to go down 0-2, you know, and we had home court advantage. And we knew how powerful that Orlando team was, you know, playing against actually my teammate right now in Dwight. So, you know, for me to be able to hit that shot, it was a huge moment for me. And I'm still a young kid at the time, so big time. The one thing I wish AD had tonight with the shot that he made, I wish we were playing at Staples. We miss our fans so much, and I can only imagine, you know, I probably would have blew the roof off Staples Center, AD hitting that shot tonight in Staples with our crowd. I would have loved for him to have that moment, because I know what that felt like for me when I was able to hit that shot, as you mentioned, versus Orlando in the Eastern Conference Finals, game two at the buzzer.
Last two questions. You know, LeBron, AD has talked about just how much he's leaned on you throughout the playoffs. And obviously he's played outstanding in the Western Conference Finals. I'm curious, what's the biggest thing that you've tried to instill in him during this time?
I think just staying even keel. That's what it's all about. The playoffs and the postseason, and the more you advance into the postseason, the emotions and the adversity, and it's going to be a roller coaster at times. And if you can just, you know, no matter if you're up, no matter if you're down, being able to keep your composure and keep your mindset on the main thing is very important. You know, this is the furthest he's gotten in his career up until this point, and I'm just happy to be here with him to, you know, give any advice for him to lean on me, or, you know, I mean, to be completely honest, shit, in the second half, I leaned on him, you know, and he brought us home, you know, so I just try to set the example early on, and we leaned on him, especially in the fourth quarter, and he brought us home.
LeBron, Anthony came to L.A., asking for this pressure and asking for this kind of burden to be a great player in the playoffs. This is obviously a process that you've gone through. What is the challenge for an athlete both to ask for that, to seek that out, but then also to perform when that moment comes?
I don't know. I think for me personally, it's always been about the man in the arena. You know, the quote from Theodore Roosevelt, you know, it's about the guy that's in the arena, that's, you know, that's gone through everything, the blood, the sweat, the tears, you know, and in our situation, the competition. But it's about the work that you put in and the belief in yourself. It's not about the doubters or the naysayers or the people who's going to talk about you and try to slander you and put you down and bring you down every single day. It's not about them, because they've never been in the arena. They don't understand. So, you know, AD, he know how special he is. And when he don't, I'll be the first one to tell him how special he is. And, you know, he wanted to be here. I'm happy he wanted to be here. You know, because if he didn't, we wouldn't have a moment like tonight. So that's what it's all about. But, you know, you put that pressure on yourself when you don't really care about what other people think. Because what other people think, it doesn't really matter, because they don't understand. Anybody can talk from outside. But if they got into the ring, or they got into the arena, probably 10 times out of 10, they shit the pants.
All right, thanks, LeBron.
Anthony Davis, only Laker to score in the last 5 minutes of the game, and both his free throws, all three of his shots, and 2 3-pointers.
I did. You know, I mean, obviously wearing the jerseys. He's hit countless shots like that, you know, to win games, regular season playoffs, finals. But, I mean, it's a special moment for me, special moment for my teammates. You know, I told Bron that in L.A., you know, right before the hiatus, you know, against the Brooklyn Nets, and, you know, same spot, slightly different play, and I missed a shot. And I was upset at myself. And he said, man, we're going to live or die with you shooting that shot. And I got the same opportunity tonight and was able to make it. But, I mean, it's a special moment for me, special moment for the team, especially in a situation like this, you know, trying to go up 2-0 against a special team who's, you know, who great competitors and, you know, going to fight, you know, for the entire 48 minutes. So to do something like that, you know, in the jersey we wore tonight, you know, it just makes it even more special.
Game 2 of the Western Conference Finals, 3-pointers win the game. How close to that was a dream of Anthony Davis growing up in Chicago? Like, how much of that kind of moment comes up?
It's a huge dream. To make it, you know, even better, you know, kind of wish he was in Staples tonight with the fans, you know, that support us, you know, all year. But, you know, still to be in that moment and hit a shot like that is still a dream. I've never hit a game winner like that before. So to hit it like that and, you know, to be a 3, it's a special moment for me. Something I'll let soak in for the next couple of hours, and then tomorrow I'll try to get, you know, get ready and prep for game 3. But, you know, being around, you know, Bron and you know, Duzz and all the other guys, they for sure going to let me, you know, make sure I hear about it, you know, at least for the rest of the night. So, you know, when you got teammates like this and the coaching staff who support you, and want you to be great and want the best for you, you know, moments like this are even better.
Hey, AD, it's Dave. Great shot, man. Frank was wiped up, and during the broadcast, we could hear him say something to you guys during a timeout, saying, hey, look at the jersey you guys are wearing on your chest. Yep. You hit the shot, you guys are undefeated in the jersey. If you miss it, you're not. Is there any extra mojo going on with the jerseys that you guys have been wearing in these playoffs, those Black Mamba ones?
We just feel like we play a little different. Our swag is a little different. You know, every time we put on those jerseys, obviously, you know, we're representing him. But, you know, especially in those jerseys, you know, it's his jerseys, the ones he created. So anytime we put it on, we feel like we want to win. And, you know, Coach made sure that, you know, we knew that, you know, in that huddle. You know, said, I mean, look at the jerseys you have on. You know, he would make big-time plays, so it's time for us to make big-time plays. I think it was like 6 minutes left in the game. And, you know, guys were able to do that. So, just looking down at the jersey and Coach telling us is just a constant reminder of that, you know, Kobe's with us, and we kind of have his spirit in those jerseys.
AD, I'm wondering what it felt like after you hit that shot, and then you turn around and you're running back towards your bench, and you see all your teammates running at you, and ran over Taylor, and like, was it all just a blur, or did you, what do you remember about that moment and what it felt like?
I remember the play before, you know, I got the floater and they come down. We knew it was going to Jokic, and, you know, I let him get to his strength, which is his right hand. You know, he got a hook, score, they go up 1, and I was kind of upset because I'm a better defensive player than that. And granted, he made a great play. You know, he made great plays, you know, throughout the course of the game. And Rondo told me, he said, you know, it's all right. He scored on you, and, you know, you go, you know, get it back. So, came off, made the shot, and then the first person I saw was Swish, you know, just jumping around everywhere, and I just kind of ran towards the bench and knocked Taylor over. And, I don't know. I mean, it's just a great moment. It's a great moment to be with the team. You know, they're cheering for you, celebrating for you. you know, like I said, it'd be even special. It was in Staples, you know, with our fans. But to have the guys that we have, the brotherhood that we have on this team, the support, you know, that I have, and, you know, every player I have on this team, from ownership to the coaching staff to, you know, the training staff, you know, to the players, and you know, everybody's one big family. And to be here and, you know, cheer for me and support me through that shot, and then, you know, after we celebrate, is a special moments like this that you keep forever.
Hey, Anthony, Rajan called this the biggest shot of your career so far.
For sure.
You're obviously on this stage, you know, it's the Lakers franchise, obviously, you know it, you get it. Is this what you wanted when you left New Orleans and when you were looking for a change? And is this the sort of kind of moment and experience that you were looking for?
It's for sure the biggest shot of my career. And, you know, when I left, I just wanted to, you know, be able to compete for a championship. And I know that, you know, moments like this comes with it, especially being in LA, the biggest market in basketball. You know, I know the quote unquote pressure is going to be on us, going to be on me, you know, especially the first year, with everything that happened last year. And then also playing alongside Bron, I know he gets criticized more than, you know, any basketball player ever. So, just being able to play alongside him, and he, you know, he kind of helped me with, you know, all this quote unquote pressure, going out and playing. You guys seen that in game 5 of the Rockets, you know, where he, you know, comes to me at the scorer's table and talks to me, you know, when I was struggling. So, just going out there and just playing basketball, he makes it a lot easy for me. But just being able to want this, you know, type of pressure, type of spotlight, and go out and play in big games and make, you know, big time plays and big time shots for my team. So it's definitely what I wanted, and, you know, the job is definitely not over until we're able to, you know, win a ring. I mean, that's when it's over, and that's when the task is completed. So, I mean, you know, it was a big shot. Like I said, we were celebrating for a couple hours, but, you know, this team fought. You know, they could have easily won this game, and we got to get ready for game 3.
All right, Calgoon. Thanks, Keisha.
AD, both Frank and LeBron brought up the shot you had against Brooklyn, did not go in. You know, how much has that shot influenced in the months since your ability to kind of get ready for taking another shot and getting another look just like that?
I mean, LeBron, I tell you, I mean, the first, it was like 4 days, I was talking to him like, damn, I should have made that shot for you. Like, I got to make that shot for you. And he's like, man, you're fine. You know, but like, I put more pressure on myself than anybody. I feel like every shot I take is supposed to go in. And, you know, I have enough confidence in my shot to make those. And then I knew that I was going to have an opportunity, you know, tonight to make, you know, almost that same exact shot from the same exact spot. And this time, I mean, I think just missing that shot and you know, making a three earlier from that same exact spot just gives me a lot of confidence. Having this, you know, this team give me a lot of confidence in shooting the ball. Coach wanted me to shoot more threes, you know, having the confidence in me to shoot those. So, you know, in situations like that, you know, having this team, you know, and this coaching staff who believes in you to make plays like that and to, you know, draw plays up for you or things like that to make you take those big shots, puts a lot of confidence in myself and confidence in, you know, in my game where I can go up and make those type of plays.
All right, just a couple more here. Rachel?
Is there anything about being at this level that you didn't expect? Kemba Walker said the other day that despite all his experience in the league, now that he's finally in the conference finals, just that every possession mattering so much. Is there anything that you've noticed despite being early for someone?
Yeah, I mean, he's right. Every possession does matter. You know, 24 turnovers tonight. I mean, we gave them 24 more possessions. I mean, we turned the ball over. We got to get shots at the rim. And, you know, things like that matter. Details matter. You know, because, you know, now teams will make you pay. You know, and we can't afford to, you know, teams are already good enough, you know, to get this far, that they're going to make plays. And when we, you know, have mistakes defensively, breakdowns offensively, not talking, not sprinting back on defense or whatever, and we get them, you know, extra points, then we make it a lot harder for us to win a game. So, you know, I say teams are great at this level. Who made it this far, players are a lot better than, you know, teams you might see in the first round. So you never want to give them extra possessions. And, you know, this guy to my left is a constant reminder, you know, of how we should play and the details and what it takes to win championships. And he constantly preaches that in the timeouts and in the film room because he's been there. And we want to be there too. So details matter, and you know, possession. It's definitely a possession game when you get this, you know, late in the playoffs.
All right, last two. We have Dan and then one on Zoom.
Hey, you mentioned details. Sometimes on a play like that, some of the details get lost. How good was the pass from Sean? Especially as you're moving, were you surprised how clean of a look you ended up with?
I think Doe wanted to come in and make that pass. Obviously, him and Brian are our best passers on the team. But I knew if I had a look, you know, a clean look to come off, he was gonna put it on the money. And I mean, it's crazy because he had Jokic's like 7 feet, right? He had a footer on him, and I started throwing a chest pass that some people would make. You know, it probably got deflected. He threw a bounce pass, you know, where he couldn't get to it, and it landed right in my hands. And I'm not sure what happened on the backside with their defense, but, you know, when I came off and I saw nobody in front of me, it was really just about taking your time and knocking down the shot. But he threw a great pass, and like I say, it's my job on this team, you know, along with Bronze, to make plays like that for us.
All right. Last question, Brad Turner.
Congratulations, AD. The last 20.8 seconds after Jokic made the shot, take us through those times, because Caruso misses a shot, Danny gets his shot blocked, you don't have a time left, Rondo comes in, shot. Those last 20.8 seconds, what was that like? What was going through the whole team's mind?
Yeah, I mean, we knew we had no time after AC had a great look at the top of the key. Danny got the rebound, dribbled out, tried to get a two-pointer. Murray blocked it, went out of bounds. We had 2.8 left or something like that. And we were running this play, you know, for Bron, who hit multiple game winners in his career, to take us home. And I just saw how, you know, they were playing it. Plumlee was, like, kind of off of me. So I knew if I kind of flew around, you know, with them kind of locked in on Bron, I was going to probably have a clean look. And I kind of just looked at Doe, and we made eye contact, and you know, he made a great pass, you know, and you know, ended up making the shot. But it was like a crazy possession. I mean, we had a couple good looks. You know, most people will, you know, give up on plays. It was a huge offensive rebound for Danny to get us that possession. So, you know, credit goes to him as well for battling inside. You know, we came out victorious. So,